Grace and peace be with you.
And also with you.
The risen Christ is with us.
Praise the Lord.
Let us pray. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that, as the scriptures are read and your word proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen. Our opening hymn, Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, stanzas 1, 2, and 4. Please stand. Please be seated.
In the Gospels, we read where Jesus says, "Where two or three are gathered in my name, God is with us." And there's great power in coming together, in being together in person or through our live stream, or maybe delayed a week through our televised broadcast. There's power in coming together in God's name, and we celebrate that you're here. And something that helps us, or it helps me, to get to know you in a more meaningful way is our Hey Card sign-up. And you can do this by filling out the Hey Card in the back of the pews and dropping that in the offering plate, or you can connect with us in a digital way through the QR code or by going online to our website. And if you will, maybe share a prayer concern, or you may have a special message for the pastors, or if you're new, and you can give us a little contact info. It will help me to reach out and get to know you. Every single week, we take up an offering as a way of worship, giving back to God all that God has given us. And we do that in and through this church. And we consider every gift given to have a prayer attached to it. So we thank you for your generosity. Let's pray. Oh God, accept these gifts that we share today. And may they bring glory and honor to your name and to your kingdom. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
We affirm our faith together by reading and or reciting this summary of our faith called the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated.
Prayers of the People. Gracious and loving God, on this Memorial Day weekend, we gather together with grateful hearts to remember and honor those who have selflessly given their lives in service to our country and who now abide with the Lord. Lord, we lift up the families and loved ones of those who have fallen. Grant them comfort and peace. Surround them with your love and help them to feel a deep appreciation of a grateful nation. We pray also for our nation's leaders and those in positions of authority. Grant them wisdom and discernment to make decisions that uphold justice, peace, and the dignity of every person. May they be guided by your principles of compassion and integrity. We express our gratitude and support to the men and women currently serving in our armed forces, asking God to give them strength and to bring them home safely. As we remember the cost of freedom, we also pray for peace in our world, inspiring us to be instruments of your peace, to work toward reconciliation and understanding among all people, to build a world where Christ's love and peace prevail. Let us pray that through our forgiveness and reconciliation, that Christ's love and the power of the Holy Spirit will overcome the bitterness and hatred that continues to separate us locally, nationally, and globally. Before we begin the Lord's Prayer, let us remember that as Christians, the Lord's Prayer asks us to forgive others. This Jesus extended also to include our enemies. As we remember those who fought and died for our country, let us also pray for those who were among our enemies at those times. Just as our nation grieved for our fallen, their families and loved ones grieved for their losses as well. So pray with me as Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thy is the kingdom, power, and glory forever. Amen.
Good morning, church. If you're able, please stand for a song. We're going to sing This Is Amazing Grace.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole world with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my pain, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life, and I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Back into order, who makes the orphan a son and daughter, the King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of his brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Yeah, this is amazing. I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered that grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my I sing for all that you've done for me. Done for me.
Reading today is from the Gospel of John, chapters 3, 1 through 17. Now, there was a Pharisee named Nicodemus, a leader of the Jews. He came to Jesus by night and said to him, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do apart from the presence of God." Jesus answered him, "Very truly, I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above." Nicodemus said to him, "How can anyone be born after having grown old? Can one enter a second time into the mother's womb and be born?" Jesus answered, "Very truly, I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and spirit. What is born of the flesh is flesh, and what is born of the spirit is spirit. Do not be astonished that I said to you, you must be born from above. The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. Nicodemus said to him, How can these things be? Jesus answered him, Are you a teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things? Very truly, I tell you, we speak of what we know and testify to what we have seen, yet you do not receive our testimony. I have told you about earthly things, and you do not believe. How can you believe if I tell you about heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent into the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Well, thank you, Millie Reeves, for reading our scripture. That was a long one, and you did an outstanding job. I have known her since she was a year old. And as you were reading that, Millie, my heart just got bigger and bigger and bigger. I want to thank Jim Rush for your prayer and for reminding us that this is this weekend, not just the unofficial start of summer, it's also Memorial Day when we remember those who have sacrificed so much so that we can enjoy the gifts and freedoms that we enjoy in this great nation of ours. Well, it's not just Memorial Day weekend, it's also Trinity Sunday. Aren't you excited? It is the only day. It's the only day in the entire church calendar all year long that we celebrate a church doctrine. Woohoo! Or teaching. The Trinity. That God is Father, Son, Holy Spirit, one in three and three in one. And if anyone ever tells you, preacher, Sunday school teacher, seminary professor, if anyone ever says to you that they understand the Trinity in full, then I would recommend running. It is St. Augustine, who was one of the fathers of the Western Church, who said, if it is God that you have understood, it is not God. This life that we're on is a mystery. And we're not here to master God. We're here to be mastered by God. It's a journey. I like to think of it as like a road trip. Our time together, these 15, 20 minutes or so, it's like a mini road trip. And guess what? I'm not the driver. I'm also not the navigator. And that's a good thing because I have a terrible sense of direction. I prefer to sit in the back next to a window where I like to let the window down and on a good day let my fingers or arms hang out so that I can experience and feel the breeze blowing for me and within me and through me. It's the Spirit. It's the Spirit of God that drives and navigates our lives. And God's Spirit blows where it wishes. You hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from, and you do not know where it's going. It is the same with everyone who is born of the Spirit. Let's pray. Come, Holy Spirit, come in the way that only you can come and enter into our hearts and minds. Shine forth your wisdom. Inspire us so that we can go out into the world and be your hope in a hurting world. And now may the words of my mouth, but also the meditations of all our hearts, be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. Once upon a time, there was this woman, and she set out to discover the meaning of life. And first, she read everything she could get her hands on, history and philosophy and psychology and religion. And this made her very, very smart, but she did not find what she was seeking. So then she decided to go and meet and visit with some really smart people. And she asked them the meaning of life. And they would have these long and sometimes lively discussions, but no two agreed on the same subject. So she didn't discover the meaning of life. And then she decided to sell all her possessions. She got rid of everything, and she traveled to some of the most exotic places, places like South America and India. And then she heard about a spiritual guru who she was told, if anyone in the world knew the meaning of life, this man would know it. And he lived in a humble little home in the deep depths of the Himalaya Mountains. And so off she went into the mountains, and she climbed and she climbed and she climbed in the freezing snow until she could hardly catch her breath. But finally, she ended up at the front door of this guru's home. And her knuckles were so frozen that when she knocked on his door, it barely made a sound. But the little old man, he heard it. And when he opened the door, he said to the woman, "Yes." And she was so glad to see this man that she almost fainted. And she said to the man, "I have traveled halfway across the world, and I have one question for you. What is the meaning of life?" And the man said to the woman, "Please come in and let's have some tea." And she immediately shouted, "No!" And then she caught herself and she's like, "What I mean is, no, thank you. I'm not here for a cup of tea. I'm here for answers. I want to know what is, and I want to know it from you, what is the meaning of life?" And again, the little old man said to her, "Please come in, let's have some tea." And so she finally gave in and she went inside. And as the little old man was preparing the tea, she began to talk. And she went on and on about all these things that she had read. And she went on and on about all these people that she had met. And she went on and on about all these exotic places that she had traveled to. And she was so busy talking, as she's talking, this man is preparing the tea, and he's listening because he can't get a word in. And then as she continues to talk and go on and on, he pours the tea into her cup. And the story goes that he kept pouring the tea. And then suddenly it began to overflow onto the floor, only she was so busy talking that she didn't even notice. But finally, when the tea began to burn her skin, she shouted to the little old man, "Stop! Don't you see that there's no more room in my cup? Stop pouring the tea." And the little man said, "You come here. You come here wanting something for me, but what am I to do?" He says, "There's no room in your cup." And then he said to her, "Come back to me when your cup is empty, and then we will talk." Now, this is a popular story in the Zen tradition. You've probably heard it before, but I think on a day like today, Trinity Sunday, it bears repeating, and that is because so many of us, especially me, so many of us are so full of ourselves. And that is why, some of you know, I'm a sticky note kind of person. I have them all over my house and all over the church in my office. And I have these little words of inspiration, but the only sticky note that I have on my computer at home, so as to notice it and see it every single day, is a quote by a Carmelite nun, Ruth Burroughs. And the quote goes like this: "Never be full of yourself, and never be empty of God. The gospel is always calling us to grow, to stretch ourselves in this way." In John's Gospel, chapter 3, there's this very smart, well-educated man, and his name is Nicodemus. That's right. He's a religious professional, a real Bible scholar, a religious leader, and ruler. In the Aramaic, Pharisee meant set apart, holy ones. The Pharisees were set apart in this way, in that they understood and they studied and they practiced religiously and in a strict way the Torah or the Mosaic law. And Nicodemus is a big deal. I mean, if he were walking around today, he probably would have published over 30 books, and he would probably have tenure at some elite or some of the finest universities and or seminaries. He knows a lot. He has mastered the world of religion. And that's why it is so ironic. Pay attention to the irony here. In that Nicodemus, what time of day does he approach Jesus? Tell me, church. At night. The scripture tells us he came to Jesus when? At night. And why? Is Nicodemus here trying to save face? Does he not want to risk being seen by his peers, the other rabbis? Or is he an insomniac? You know what that is? There are some here in the room. Maybe you just can't sleep. You know, you want to sleep. Your body's tired, but for some reason, you just can't fall asleep or stay asleep. Maybe he's a night owl and he just prefers studying the Torah in the wee hours of the night. We don't know. All that we know, and John wants us to know it, is that Nicodemus remains in the what? Dark. Say it like you mean it. Nicodemus is in the dark. That's right. Now, if you know much about John's gospel, you'll know that light and darkness, this is a huge repeated theme in this gospel. And here's what it means, simply put. Light means that you get it. You get Jesus. You understand. You have divine spiritual understanding. And dark means you don't. You don't get Jesus. And try as he might, and he does try, Nicodemus does not get it. He remains in the dark. And of course, again, this is so ironic because he knows. He knows so much. I mean, a Pharisee would have started studying the Torah when they were little children. He has studied the Bible his entire lifetime. He knows. And Jesus says to him, unless someone is born anew, and some translations say born again or born from above, unless you're born of the Spirit, says Jesus, it is not possible to see God's kingdom. If you think about it, birth, no matter how many times it happens, it is always a gift. You know, we were all born into this world, and none of us did anything to make our births happen. Birth is something that happens to us. It's not something that you and I can accomplish. And so it is, says Jesus, with the Spirit of God. God's Spirit blows where it wishes. Have you ever been given a gift and you did not receive it? Anybody ever, has this happened to you? My first week here in this appointment, a decade ago now, I remember I was appointed here, and my good friend Tom McCormick, faithful Tom McCormick, he's a good friend of y'all, many of yours, you too, and he had heard that I was a vegetarian, that I don't eat very much meat. And so he cooked or had prepared, I don't know which, and as I recall, it was a vegetarian lasagna. And he came to the office that day, the church office, and it was early in the day. And so he said, I'm going to put this in the church refrigerator. Now take it home and enjoy it, and welcome to the church. Well, I was so busy and so dead set on making a good impression here at this church in the first week I was here, that one day went by, weeks went by, months went by. I never ate that lasagna. And it's a regret. I regret it to this day. Turns out I'm not the only one that sometimes forgets, is so preoccupied, so full of myself that we forget to receive gifts given to us. Alice McKenzie, she is a professor of preaching and worship at Perkins School of Theology in Dallas, Texas. She pointed out something to me I'd never thought about. She points out how many Americans, how many people living in the United States fail to redeem their gift cards. Did you know this? Well, there was an article back in 23 that said that nearly half, 47% of Americans have at least one unused gift card, gift voucher, or store credit that they have yet to redeem. Get this, these gifts aren't small change. And I gave a lot of gifts for graduation, gift cards for graduation this year, so I hope this isn't, maybe we've turned a corner. But anyway, get this, according to my research, the average value per person of unredeemed gifts is around $187, which is a total value, get this, $23 billion nationwide. Now, how can I turn this into a stewardship sermon? Maybe we should give what we have in gift cards in addition to our regular giving. That just came to me. Good idea. You know, it could be a real inflation-busting strategy. This is real money. Why are we not redeeming these gift cards? Well, the number one reason is we forget about them, or we lose them, or maybe we should say misplace them. We should redeem those gift cards. I'm just saying. And then I started thinking, before I get too judgmental, I started thinking about this drawer in my kitchen at the parsonage. I call it my catch-all drawer. And I have a picture of it. And you can see that it's not as organized as I'd like for it to be. And that's because there's just all kind of things I need. Nose spray, scissors. Now I need glasses. You see the tape measure in there. Pencils, pens, things I need. But in that drawer, as I was looking at it, taking a closer look this weekend, or who am I kidding, late last night, I noticed there's some things I don't really need. And I thought, you know, I love my props. So I thought I'd bring with me some things I found in that drawer that maybe aren't that necessary. So here they are. Here's an extra AirTag. Don't even have a use for it. It's just in the drawer. And then I have a, somebody gave me this. So anyway, maybe I do need it. It's a bookmark in the image of one of my favorite characters, the Incredible Hulk. Oh. Inside the box here, things I may not need. What is this? Fidget spinner. Yep. Wonder what this is. Speedo. This is an extra strap for my swim goggles. Better hold on to that. Wooden chopsticks. We all need a pair of these. A shell from who knows where. Oh, of course. This is flower food, supposed to help cut flowers last extra long. I'm sure I need this. And of course, final item here, a stack of unredeemed gift cards. Now, this is pretty vulnerable of me because some of you probably gave me these. Oh, here's one to Subway. Don't even know the amount or expiration date. Here's one to Sonic. Here's one to the Marble Slab Creamery, and it's for $10. Ding, ding, ding. Probably can't even buy a kid's portion with that amount, but thank you for your generosity. Speaking of generosity, here's a generous one, $40 at the Half Shell Oyster House. I know where I'll be having lunch today. Redeemed, unredeemed gift cards. Why? Why have I yet to redeem these? Is it because I'm so busy? So preoccupied? So full of myself? Let's get back to the Bible. Nicodemus makes two more appearances in John's gospel. Just two. So that's a total of how many times that Nicodemus appears in John's gospel. I've given you plenty of time to formulate the math. How many times? Three. Good. Stay with me. I'm about to wrap it up. Ha ha. So Nicodemus is going to appear two other times in John's gospel. The second time is in the seventh chapter, where Jesus is being tested, and he's going to try to defend Jesus, but it's a little, too late, and his defense doesn't really carry any weight. And the final time that Nicodemus will reappear, anybody know? After the crucifixion, at the burial of Jesus. I thought I would read it. It's from John 19. It's entitled, Jesus' Body is Buried, the Common English Bible. After this, Joseph of Arimathea asked Pilate if he could take away the body of Jesus. Joseph was a disciple of Jesus, but a secret one, because he feared the Jewish authorities. Pilate gave him permission, so he came and he took the body away. Nicodemus, the one who had at first come to Jesus at night, was there too. He brought a mixture of myrrh and aloe, nearly 75 pounds in all. And following Jewish burial customs, they took Jesus' body and they wrapped it with spices and linen cloths. There was a garden in the place where Jesus was crucified, and in the garden was a new tomb in which no one had ever been laid. And because it was the Jewish preparation day and the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus in it. I wonder, did Nicodemus ever get it? Did he ever come out of the dark and into the light? Does he ever get Jesus, the true meaning of life? All we know, we don't know. All we know from this passage of Scripture is his hands are loaded. They're full. He's carrying 75 Roman pounds of burial spices made up of myrrh and aloe. And according to a commentary I read this week, that's enough to bury around 75 bodies. Poor Nicodemus. I so resonate with him. He's overcompensating once again, trying so hard. And church people, we're meant to see ourselves in Nicodemus. And the invitation of John's gospel is that we don't have to work so hard, because we can't achieve the true meaning of life. It is a gift. And the invitation is to open our hands and our hearts and our minds and to empty our cups. It's a journey. It is a lifelong journey. And it's a lot like a road trip, only you and I aren't driving and you and I are not navigating. So sit back, let the window down, feel the breeze, experience the breeze blowing for you, within you, and through you. God's Spirit blows where it wishes, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from, and you do not know where it's going. And it's the same. It is the same for everyone and all born of the Spirit. So be it, and so it is. Amen. The invitation today is to consider joining the church. Here's why. You can't be a Christian by yourself. It's impossible. You need the gift and guidance of the Holy Spirit to drive and navigate your life. And you need church, community, people to walk alongside you so that you don't feel so all alone. And they will help you celebrate your gifts, and you can help them celebrate their gifts. Modeling for us how to join a church is our own Hayes, Melissa and John Finkley's son. He's here from Georgia, Atlanta, actually. And he joined Peachtree United Methodist Church last Sunday. And I came up to Hayes and I asked him, you know, you're a young person. Tell me, why did you decide to join the church? And he gave me a great reason. Listen up, folks, because this applies to some of you. Well, he said, I had been attending there for so long, I figured it was time to join. We make it so complex when it's really so simple. So, as we sing our closing song today, if you feel led to be a part of this church fellowship, we're not perfect, but it would be my joy and my delight to welcome you into our formal membership. What are we singing today, James?
We are going to celebrate Memorial Day. We're singing America the Beautiful.
Let's stand together.
All about gratitude.
Let me make a quick announcement before we sing that closing song. We have a special anthem planned for Father's Day, and it involves the children. No age particular, anyone who feels like a child or is a child that would like to learn this little short insert, part of the singing in the anthem. If you would stay after church for just a minute, and we'll familiarize you with it this Sunday as well as next Sunday. So y'all, come on forward. Let's have our children appear. Thank you, James.
Here we go. Oh, beautiful, for heroes prove in liberating strife, who more than self their country love and mercy more than life. America, America, fine, till all success be nobleness and every gain skies, for amber with of rain, for purple mountains, majesties of the fruited plain. Good.
hope everyone has a safe and fun weekend. And let us remember that life is short and we do not have much time to gladden the hearts of those who travel the way with us. So be swift to love, make haste to be kind, and may the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with us all.